Hey guys, Aaron Chapman with Security National Mortgage again. As I've been saying, I'm going to be bringing a guest on here to bring a lot of background to what I've been saying. So I'm going to introduce you to Mr. Barry Habib. This gentleman, one of the most brilliant economic minds I've followed, and he may not know this or remember this, but I met you back in 2003 in Palm Springs at an event. And it was then when I signed up and have been following everything you've been producing ever since. So, you know, the information he's going to bring here is going to, at least he's the individual who brought me what I brought to you guys. So figure, why not bring the man to it? Thank you, Barry, for being here.
Thank you. That's very kind of you, Aaron.
Well, I say it's what you have done for us in the mortgage industry has been huge. You know, the education that we've received, the information, I didn't know what drove rates until, you know, I happened across what you were producing. I happen to have in the broker shop I started a bond trader, former bond trader, that I'd ask him, is today a locked day or is today a float day? And he would tell me, and you explained why. So thank you for that. And thank you for what you produce. I mean, I'm staring at the economic calendar, and it's amazing stuff that's sitting out there right now. Looking at the spikes in jobless claims compared to 2009 and what has happened is, it's some amazing data you're putting out there. Thank you for that. So the one thing that I wanted to really get into is the real estate investors, the one who are watching what we're talking about today. We've brought to them the history, or at least I started producing this when the market started to freak out in March, started putting out this content so people would know what interest rates were going to do. And then when the market started to come back, we got excited, but then you produced that information about what is happening with the servicing side of the business. So the main worry that I have right now for those who are watching has to do with the temptation of forbearance and okay. If they consider doing that. So let's talk a little bit about that.
So mortgage bankers, they provide a really important function, of course, to the housing industry. You know, think about how it would be if you couldn't get a mortgage, what would happen to the housing industry? And part of the mortgage process is something that's called servicing. Now, the servicer doesn't own the mortgage, doesn't hold the mortgage, but they provide the vital function of collecting the payments, paying the taxes, paying the insurance, answering your questions. It's the company you write your check to. That's your servicer. They're not going to hold the mortgage. It's kind of like a superintendent apartment building. So in an effort to help, and it has been a sincere effort to help, to stabilize things, and as you can see, all the money that's being thrown at this crisis, because this is a crisis, the government sometimes has, oftentimes has unintended consequences. I think it was Ronald Reagan who said some of the most dangerous words that you might ever hear are, "I'm from the government, I'm here to help." So what we saw happening, and I think what you're referring to, where I was very instrumental and where I got in front of the Fed and got them to stop, was when they were purchasing too many mortgage-backed securities. And what that did was that caused an unintended consequence that people, just because they didn't understand how the plumbing works, caused margin calls. This is because in order to promise somebody a rate, what people call locking in, there is a period of time until the loan closes, from the time the customer is told that they're promised a rate and locked in till the time it closes, where that interest rate is actually moving around, but it's the lender's responsibility and liability to make sure that that customer gets the rate they're promised. So in order to mitigate that, they do something called hedging. So you need a counterbalancing way. So if rates go up, you have to bet that by rates going up, you are able to make money or profit by rates going up enough to offset the loss so you can keep your promise to the customer. So if that rate went from 4 to 4.5, it's going to cost you a lot more money to give the customer 4. You have to make a profit in another trade, an offsetting trade, so that you could do that. Well, when rates go down, it's the same thing. The lender would make more money if rates went down, except that the trade that they used to protect them in case rates went up, that's lost money. But they offset each other and it's fine. But there comes a timing issue, and that timing issue was not understood by the Fed, where if rates move down very rapidly, and they were, with the Fed buying $183 billion in a week, the previous week, $67 billion. I mean, crazy, 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 crazy numbers. That while you would say, okay, the lender will make more money when the loan closes, the trade that they're using to hedge this got so upside down that they were being called for money. And so many huge companies were calling me and telling me, Barry, we cannot stay in business another week if this persists, because they were upside down so much money because they have to pay the broker dealer in advance of the loan's closing. They had the money, but because of the timing issue and cash flow, regardless of how well capitalized they were, the numbers were outstanding. I mean, there's only so many checks you could write for $40 or $50 million every day or other day before it really starts to get scary. So I was able to get in front of the Fed and explain this to them, and to their credit, you take a look at what's happened since the 30th of March up until now, they have had an extraordinarily steady hand, and we are looking at, you know, a much better situation. But just as we jumped out of that fire with cash flow already depleted, we now enter into forbearance. Mm-hmm. Forbearance is something that is designed to help people, and it's actually a very good thing because it means that if you have a mortgage and you know you come up to a hardship, there's some assistance that you don't have to make your mortgage payment. But you know, it's nice to say what actually happens in the process is another thing. And what was also done was, in the government's desire to do this expeditiously, they didn't really put the proof that you've suffered a hardship, like lost your job, on the person asking for forbearance. And that creates moral hazard because people were going to try and game the system, thinking that it's free money. So let's explain all those things. See, with forbearance, the good thing about it is it does help people, and it means that they don't have to put their home up for sale. It means it keeps stability in the housing market. But when you have people that don't really need it gaming the system, it just exacerbates the problem. And there's enough people who will need it. I mean, the unemployment rate's going above 20%. There's going to be enough shock in the system. But the servicer's role, remember, they don't guarantee the loan. That FHA does, or Fannie Mae or Freddie Mac, they're guaranteeing the loan anyway. The servicer's just like a superintendent in an apartment building. They're just making the collection and passing it on. Well, what the government was saying with this is, okay, here's what people don't know about forbearance. If you don't make your mortgage payment, the ultimate investor still has to get the money. And it's up to the servicer to advance the payments. Think about how crazy that is. Now, this happens from time to time when somebody's delinquent and then the servicer chases them down. But under normal circumstances, those numbers are so small that the servicer knows this is part of it. But now you start adding all these forbearance requests, and people that are going to game the system with this as well. And the servicer is put in a position where they don't have enough money to front the payments to the investor. Now, in FHA loans, this has been contemplated, and there's been a pass-through facility where FHA is saying, yeah, you know what? We get it. It's our responsibility. We're guaranteeing it anyway. So you servicer, you're just a middle person that's just providing a function and getting a tiny fee for that function, just like a superintendent does in an apartment building. So what we're going to do is we're going to create a pass-through facility. So you can borrow the money from us. You'll advance it to the investor. And then later, when this all gets sorted out, the money that you borrowed will be reimbursed to you. You'll pay back the money you borrowed, and it's okay. Now, Mark Calabria, who runs the FHFA, I know there's a lot of initials, which basically is in charge of Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac, about 50% of the mortgages that are out there. So it's a lot, has not done this. And he says, I don't think it's such a big deal. This is a man who's never really as much run a lemonade stand or had a newspaper route. This is an academic, this is an ivory tower individual who doesn't get it, never originated a loan, doesn't, I mean, his experience with mortgages might've been that he did a refinance once in his life. You know, this is the man that is in charge of Fannie Mae and Freddie Mac. So it's the reason why it's just so scary is because he has not been responsive to this. And what I'm afraid of is that, you know, it's analogous to that superintendent apartment building saying, hey, listen, all the rents that are due, I want them anyway. And even though you don't own the building, if you can't collect them from them, then here's what you do. You have to advance it to me out of your checkbook. The superintendent apartment building will say, what are you freaking nuts? I mean, it's your building. You own it. I'm just working for you here to collect this stuff. And you told everybody not to pay it. And since you told them not to pay it, you want me to front the payments to you? Imagine if you're listening to this. And the
superintendent's only been making 60 grand a year.
What's that?
And the superintendent's only making 60
grand. Yeah, there you go.
He doesn't have the money to do that.
That, and hence that's the problem. And this is what Mark Calabria doesn't understand. And if you put the mortgage industry to a point where it's crippled, what's going to happen to everybody who's listening here is your value of your home. What's going to happen to it?
Oh, yes. Yeah.
So now let's explain forbearance. As I mentioned, forbearance is a good thing because what forbearance does is it puts you in a position where if you really need the help and you really can't make the payments, at least you don't have to put your home up for sale under a duress situation, which would be bad for the housing market too. So this is good. But is forbearance forgiveness? No, you have to pay it back. You have to pay it. No government's going to bail you out. You're going to have to pay it back. If you don't make your mortgage payment for 6 months or for 12 months, which is the max, you still owe it. You'll either owe it right afterwards, which is going to be tough to come up with, or you're going to have to redo your mortgage in a modification or a higher payment plan for a period of time, or there's going to be a second lien that's placed called, in the case of FHA, a secretary's lien put on that you have to pay back. Now, the government says you shouldn't have your credit score drop because of it. Okay, that's possible, but every lender out there knows if you went into forbearance. And they're going to look at that and they're going to see, oh, no payment, no payment, no payment, no payment. Guess what? No mortgage for you, no soup for you. And what they're going to say is, no, you're too risky. I'm not going to do your loan. So if rates drop, which they will, if you want to buy a home, which you may want to do, you can't save money on a refinance. You can't take advantage of this stuff in the future for a long time. So this forbearance issue, if you have no choice, you say, well, look, I got no choice. I can live with those consequences. But if you can make your payment, you're not getting any financial benefit, but you're risking your ability to maybe refinance in the future. And you know what else? You're doing something morally wrong too, because you're taking it away from the person who really needs it. Just be thankful to God that that's not you. Don't hurt somebody else who really needs that money.
And these being real estate investors, right? So I've had calls from investors that called me up, and some of them weren't my investors. They came from other sources. They said, I've got 8 mortgages. My tenants are making the payment, but I'm thinking I will do this forbearance for 3 or 4 months and build up my reserves. I'm like, no, that's not reserves. You're going to have to pay it back. He goes, oh, I called my mortgage companies. They'll said they'll put it on the back end. I'm like, you talked to a $12 an hour servicing person that doesn't understand it.
If that real estate investor says, oh, wow, real estate values are going to drop here. We know that. They're going to come back. But during this period, we know that they're going to drop. How much are they going to drop? 5%, 10%, 12%? But they will come back. 2021, 2022, things will come back. Things will be. All the demographics for real estate are way too good. There's simply more demand than supply. And there are so many other metrics. Price to replacement ratio, affordability, price to rent ratio. There's so many metrics that real estate will do extremely well, will lead us out of this. So if you are that real estate investor and you can make your payment and you are collecting the rent, it's so foolish for you to now go into forbearance, because if you're an investor by nature, when the real time to invest, to take advantage of a real opportunity to buy real estate at a discount comes along, guess what? You're out of luck on a mortgage, my friend.
You lost it.
So, and by the way, what was your benefit? To let money sit in your account, that you're going to get a checking account, that you're going to get 0 interest or 0.1% interest. So you're going to make $20 maybe and lose the opportunity to make hundreds of thousands of dollars on an opportunity of a lifetime. It's foolish, but it's not communicated. So people are mistaken. They first think it's forgiven, which it's not. And then in the case of the person who spoke to you, oh, they'll tack it on their belt. Might as well build up reserve. There's a cost for that.
And that's what we're here for, to explain to them, not only is the cost there, you're still going to pay the payments, but then there's interest that's going to be accruing on you as well.
There will be not be interest on.
Oh, there won't. Okay. I did not know that.
It's okay. There won't be interest on that. And I know it's very confusing. So these are all situations. And by the way, what you're really doing at the present time is you're taxing the system to the point, if people can't get mortgages, how are you ever going to sell your home? If rates start to skyrocket, or if you're already seeing restrictions, jumbos gone, non-QM, meaning those with more compromised credit or employment situation, gone, can't do that anymore. Credit scores being raised to 700. What happens to the real estate market if a tiny segment of the population can now be the only ones that get a mortgage? If only the super, super, super uber buyers out there can get a mortgage, what's going to happen? So while you're thinking about building reserves so that you gain $15 in your checking account, you lose hundreds of thousands of dollars, and then you get stuck with a property you can't sell. That's how important this is. We will destroy our housing and mortgage industry.
And then on top of that, the guidelines for the real estate investor will tighten.
Of course they will.
We're not going to see the opportunity to use rents to qualify if we keep this up. We've got to protect that segment of the business that we're trying to help. The real estate investor
You nailed it. You have to think long-term here. You have to think, first of all, for the good of others too. I mean, from a moral standpoint and for the health long-term of the economy, we have to think about these things. There's no motivation to do this financially. You gain zero. You have to pay it back. So why do it if you don't need it and take it away from somebody who does? Why hurt your own values of real estate? Why hurt your prospects to save money on a refinance? Why hurt your ability to take advantage of the decline we're going to see in real estate values to really capitalize and cash in and make a significant profit and opportunity into the future? It's just no other word for it, but foolish.
Agreed. Barry, thank you very much. What I've been telling all my people is good judgment comes from experience. Experience comes from bad judgment. There is amazing experience here, guys. Don't take anything for granted that Barry just offered to you. It's worth millions. So again, I appreciate you coming. I appreciate you allowing us to take this time. And guys, look him up. You'll see some amazing things. And when you do the calculation on his age, you'll be ridiculously surprised.
Aaron, thank you. By the way, Aaron, thanks for all the good work you're doing for so many people and getting the word out there and being a great leader.
Thank you, man. And I appreciate you giving me the data to do that, sincerely.
You bet. You be well, my friend.
Thank you, brother.
Bye-bye.